I would like to call this meeting of the College of Complexes to order. I would like to welcome everyone to the College of Complexes tonight. My name is Tim, and oops, we're gonna do a do-over, I gotta get my notes.
Are you gonna sign, guys? He's a famous guy.
Sorry. Welcome to the College of Complexes, Miracle.
You've been there already.
I know, I have to do a do-over for the tape. My name is Tim, and welcome to the College of Complexes. The College of Complexes meets every Saturday night at 6 p.m. at Dapper's East Restaurant at 2101 West Addison. The college consists of the following format. First, we have a brief announcements period. Then we have our speaker. Then we have our question and answer session. And then we have our infamous rebuttal period. Tonight's speaker is Trevor Gervalis. How do you say it? Gervalis or?
Genwali.
Okay.
Yeah.
Trevor Genwali, lead organizer for Common Cause Illinois. It's a nonpartisan watchdog group whose mission is to promote open, ethical, and accountable government of the state, local, and what?
Tim, you got the wrong program. This is Illinois Environmental Council.
April Fools.
Let's start over again.
April Fools.
March 11th.
Boy, did I just screw up rough, boy, big time, and I'm supposed to be in Toastmasters.
You're fired.
All right, we're not gonna do a do-over because I'll leave this call as running. Seeing as how I put a nice big size 12 foot in my mouth right now, hopefully, which is something everybody does with size 14 maybe. All right, tonight's speaker. March 11th, the Illinois Environmental Council engages in education and outreach and provides a forum for environmentalists and serves as the enhanced community's eyes, ears, and voice in Springfield. Since its founding in 1975 by a group of dedicated grassroots environmentalists, IEC has sponsored issue advocacy campaigns and projects by allowing environmental organizations to pool their resources and create a higher profile for environmental issues. Today, IEC represents 60 environmental and community organizations and nearly 500 individuals from throughout Illinois. I need to get your name again.
Walling.
Okay. And Miss Jen Walling will be speaking tonight.
Let's welcome. All right. Let's welcome our speaker.
All right.
All right.
Okay, good evening everyone, and thank you so much for having me tonight to this event. I'm really excited to speak to you all about the work that we're doing. And I will take questions afterward, but during some of this too, if there are some thoughts, I'll have some different stopping points. My name is Jen Walling. I'm the Executive Director of the Illinois Environmental Council. And IEC, we say we serve as the eyes, ears, and voice of the environmental community in Springfield. And we were formed by different environmental groups because they did not have consistent representation in Springfield that represented a broad sector of environmental groups. And so those organizations formed IEC in 1975, and we have been around ever since. We kind of serve as the lobbyists in Springfield for the environmental community and for environmental organizations. There are different organizations that have lobbyists and lobbying teams. Sierra Club has a Springfield representative and a really excellent district office program and grassroots program, for example. Or Environmental Law and Policy Center has a couple of different lobbyists. And there are a few at each organization, but IEC kind of serves as the lobbyists for, now we're at over 80 organizations, and including a lot of those organizations that don't have their own lobbyists. So I'm going to talk a little bit. Some of my favorite work is working for those organizations that are very small that notice problems that we can help them fix through legislation. So that's what we work on. I often find, and a lot of this for you in the beginning, I feel like there may be some experts here about how the state legislature, the civics of the state legislature functions, but I often find that people don't understand just the rules of the state legislature and just the civics of how it works. So I'm going to spend basically the first half of the presentation talking about the how Springfield works, and then talk about some of the bills that we have on tap right now and what you can do to contact your legislator, etc. And so that is what we're going to talk about tonight. And this is a little bit about what IEC does. Right now, we're in the beginning of, kind of in the beginning of session, because committee deadline hasn't happened yet. But 2 months in, right now I have about 200 bills that I'm tracking. It'll go up to probably 250 by the end of the year. We put together news, so if you want to be at ilenviro.org, you can join our newsletter list, and we send updates just basically every week of what happened, what we expect to happen, and action alerts when we need you to call your legislator or other decision makers. We have a lobby day on April 6th. I'll talk more about that later if you want to join us. We work really heavily on building relationships with legislators, and we do an environmental scorecard for legislators, which I've put on the back table, our 2016 scorecard that was just released. So this is where I want to start with the very short civics lessons, and then I have a little more that I'm going to dig into. And so for those of you here, if you don't understand how Springfield works, or you've never been exposed to any of this before, you know, don't worry, because the state legislature is made to be inaccessible to the public, and it's made to be confusing to understand. So that is something that we try really hard to, why I'm always talking about civics, and I'm always talking about how the state legislature works, because I want to make sure that people understand how they can be effective advocates within the system that's out there. And I know there's other advocacy efforts going on, but my specific mission is within our legislative system there. So, you know, don't feel bad about it, but we can very easily learn. So five things that I like to go over, these are my top lines, and then, like I said, we'll go into it. One of them is that the state legislature actually has deadlines for things, and I have a little bit about how a bill becomes a law, but in the Illinois legislature, other legislatures, you can pass a bill parallel in two chambers and then give it to the governor. You can't do that in Illinois. You have to pass a bill, send it over to the other chamber. It has to be identical when it gets out, or it has to go back through the first chamber, and then it goes to the governor. But for each step, and if there's a simple, kind of simple overall process that a bill gets introduced, it goes to committee, there's a second reading, and then a third reading is a vote in each chamber. And for each of those steps along the way, there are deadlines. I think a lot of people don't realize that the legislature is basically in only January through May, and a little bit, maybe October, November. There's sometimes where they do special session, but I used to work for a state legislator, and we would get calls from people in, you know, August when they weren't in session about doing X, Y, and Z. And while we record those, they're not necessarily the most effective, because, you know, that medical marijuana bill is not going to get called over the summer unless there's some crisis. So they often don't go in during that time period. The last couple of years, they've been in a lot more, but dealing with budget issues and not doing anything. But it's really important to know what those deadlines are. I also, in a lot of ways, really appreciate the deadlines, because I think when you're working with the city council, or if you're working with the federal government, not having deadlines means that legislators, decision makers can almost not be honest with you about when something's getting called, because they can keep putting you off, like it's gonna be at the next council meeting, it's gonna be at the next council meeting, and that bill doesn't die. In the state legislature, if they don't call it by a certain point, so March 17th is the Senate committee deadline, and March 31st is the House committee deadline, unless they get an extension or something else happens, I'll talk about magic in a little bit, that bill is basically, it's dead, and it goes back into the Rules Committee, and that bill can't move forward anymore unless somebody asks for it to be moved forward. So I like that aspect of the state legislature, because you kind of know the status of where something is, and a legislator can't a lawmaker can't be dishonest with you about, oh, we're going to call it later, we're going to call it later. So that's something I appreciate. I'd also say the media often gets it wrong and what they cover, and obviously, you know, there's some overall opinions in that, but I often find that the vast majority of news stories are about bills that have been introduced and not about bills that have passed. There's, of course, the overall bills, but I'll give you an example of one year there was this bill on that would have permitted shooting Asian carp, so we'd given permits to shoot Asian carp. And now there are a lot of, it's a funny idea, and there's a lot of, like, policy reasons why that is probably not a good idea to be shooting into the water from a boat. But, you know, that bill never even got put into a committee that just got introduced. So the legislator did not even care about the bill enough to, like, ask for it to be assigned to committee. And there are a ton of news stories about this bill that just had been introduced. And at the same time, I was dealing with a bill that would have created a confined disposal facility in Lake Michigan outside of Waukegan. So basically a big bag of PCBs. They're going to put PCBs in a bag, put it in the lake, build stuff over it. There's lots of these confined disposal facilities. But we're dealing with this, and we ultimately killed that bill. But, you know, they're going on at the same time. I'm like, here's Asian carp, and here's PCBs in the lake. So, you know, we work on that and trying to get more coverage on stuff that passes. But I find the vast majority of things you read about Springfield are at bill introduction deadline. And then another thing, it's a lot easier to kill a bill than it is to pass a bill. Of course, there are times where a lot of stuff passes I don't like, but it's a lot, you know, Springfield legislators, and that's my next point, they love to have an agreed bill where they can say that, you know, that most parties agree to this thing so it can move forward. I rarely have, there have been a few bills where I don't have any opponents that I've had some trouble with, but, you know, if they see an opponent, there almost automatically can be a stoppage on some of these things. So that can be, that's just an interesting thing about Springfield. And then, you know, the other part, it's a lot of people will predict the possibility of whether a bill can pass the committee or pass the House or the Senate. And one of the things that we work really hard on is understanding what the roll call is and how many votes we have. Because, you know, you can predict that this thing, you can say it's a good idea, but you really need to have enough votes to pass this thing. And we have a lot of ways of, you know, really getting to where people are going to stand and how they're going to vote in the end on a bill and know whether to call it or not. Of course, you know, we're not always right. Like, this is super embarrassing, but a couple of years ago, there was a bill in Environment Committee, and I did not count the number of votes I needed correctly. So I thought I needed 9 votes, and I needed 10. And I got there, and we got our 9 votes, and then they were like, you know, bill stays in committee, and I was like, oops. I did not count how many that we needed. So despite that we had some bipartisan support, I just didn't get there. So, you know, that later on we were able to move that forward, but embarrassing at the time, especially since I've been doing this for so long. So here's a few things, and I'm going to go in this. So people often ask me about, like, what works in contacting your legislator and what's the most effective thing to do. And so I would say, you know, not contacting your legislator about anything is basically, like, on the floor, right? And a form email or a letter is, like, right here. It's still way better than doing nothing. I mean, form emails or letters are probably, you know, the junkiest way to interact with a legislator, but they will keep counts, a lot of them, of, like, oh, I just got 300 emails, or there's often a time where I'll hear from legislators, oh, I've been getting form emails about this, tell me more about the subject. So it does do something, it's not purposeless, so if it's something that you care about and that's the only thing you can do, do it. And then I have these two here, but personal letters and phone calls where you're proving you're an actual person and you're personalizing the issue with legislators are some of the best ways that you can interact with them in the least amount of time. And so often legislators, when they speak on the floor about an issue, they will tell stories from different pieces that letters that they've gotten from folks. I've seen it happen quite a lot. So personal letters or emails, really important. And then in-person meetings, like I said, Sierra Club has a really great district office program. You can always hook up with them if you're interested in environmental issues. And But I do, we'll put a caveat on in-person meetings. This is part of knowing the schedule, is that this time of year, legislators are legitimately in Springfield. Tuesday through Thursday, some of them Monday through Thursday if they have other committee meetings. So, and you know, they're people, they probably want to take a weekend after they have, you know, been there 3 or 4 days. So just take that in mind when you're trying to get in contact with them this time of year. They're usually only in Mondays, Fridays. And it might be better to actually go to Springfield and meet with them, which is another really important way to contact your legislator. We have a lobby day, April 6th, that anybody can come to and talk about the environmental agenda that we have for the year, et cetera. But then, of course, developing a relationship is always the key way to get anybody to do anything. And we often have, there are legislators that have such good relationships with different environmentalists in their district that I, as a lobbyist, I would go talk to them, and of course, you know, there's the whole, well, I would go talk to the legislator, and they'll be like, oh, I gotta call Barbara in my district, and Barbara's gonna tell me whether I can vote on that bill or not. And I'm like, that's great, that's fabulous, I'm glad that we have volunteers and grassroots people who have developed relationships like that, and I want every legislator to have the environmentalist that they call. Of course, I want that environmentalist to agree with my position on it, but I want that because those are really key to getting the best things done, is having those relationships. So, and this was just, I'm gonna skip over some of these. You know, building relationships with elected officials before you ever have to ask for something can be really important too, because they know who you are already. And then, you know, maybe there's more trust in what they have, especially if you're working with an organization. You know, if you've built a relationship with them already, you know, if you ever need something, it's way easier to get it. I included a little bit of stuff. So if any of you are with a nonprofit organization, I have some things on what the test is for whether a nonprofit organization can lobby or not. And this is something really important because I think a lot of people think that nonprofit organizations cannot lobby. IEC is both a C3 and a C4 organization because we do so much lobbying that we need to have that other organization. And our lobbying money is not tax deductible. So people who donate to our C4 and our members that are part of IEC, those are not tax deductible contributions because they go directly towards lobbying. But other nonprofit organizations, as long as they meet this insubstantial part test or this 501H election, which has more percentages to it, and it's actually a pretty big percentage, 20 or 25%, depending on whether it's grassroots or direct lobbying that a nonprofit can spend its resources on. So there are options for nonprofits to get involved. And then I, you know, there's still stuff that's not lobbying. Like, we take a lot of legislators on tours. I've taken a lot of legislators to sustainable farms lately because we've been working really hard on nutrient pollution issues and different other open spaces, that sort of thing. So that's pretty important. And this is, if any of you ever get here and you're wondering, do I need to meet ethics rules and register as a lobbyist if some of you do a lot of work in this field? So if you just go down for a lobby day, you don't need to, and if you're just representing yourself, you don't need to. The threshold in Illinois to register as a lobbyist is if you're getting more than $500 a year in compensation from your employer or something, either expenses or salary. So if any of you ever wondered about that, like you're going down to Springfield a whole lot for something, that is what the threshold is for lobbying in Illinois, so most people don't need that. But when they do, even nonprofit organizations have to spend around $700 a year to lobby to register only one lobbyist, so it can be pretty expensive. And I'll give you this, and I'm gonna click through a lot of these pretty quickly, but ilge.gov is the website for the Illinois legislature, and this is where you can look at current law, you can look at the list of legislators, you can look at the calendar, you can watch committee hearings in the legislature live. When I started this job, or even before, you could only watch the Illinois House or the Illinois Senate live. And now, almost every committee hearing, you can either have audio or watch it live. It's almost at the point, I think now, where you can get video of every committee hearing. And so if you're wondering what's going to go on in that committee and you really want to watch it, some of them start late, you should just know that. But you know, you can very easily go and watch it live online, which is a really good thing for transparency. and a couple of other resources. There's bills from previous years on the website. There's a place to file a witness slip, which I think if I don't have slides on that, I'm going to talk about at the end. And then administrative rules, so if you wanted to read the rules that go with the statutes. And this is just the schedules up online. This is just an example of what I talked about, of how many days were in a week, and that they have deadlines. The other point that I often want to bring up is, you know, I often get a lot with people who know some about the legislature. They always are, you know, they talk about rules or assignments committee in the Senate as being this scary, awful thing that, you know, this is how Mike Madigan kills all the bills. But I just want to make the point that rules or assignments committees are not always awful, because every single bill starts in rules or assignments committee. So when it's introduced in the House or in the Senate, it first, you know, goes to first reading, which under our Constitution, any proposals need to be read three times, and they literally do read them three times. They may not all be in the building when they do it, but there will be a time when the clerk in each chamber will just read the bill number and its title. They usually are in, but they'll just read it all. So it is read three times. But you'll see with the first one, it goes to first reading, and then it goes to Rules Committee. And then with the second one, you know, it went to Assignments Committee, and then it went back to Assignments Committee when it didn't meet the deadline. So that is eventually bad, because, you know, the Speaker or leadership does have a lot of power over whether it gets an extension that it's able to move, but it's not always a terrible thing. And the Illinois House has, well, actually both of them at this point, when I was working 10 years ago with the Senate, it definitely was, the Senate used to also be rules, and it definitely was a place where things died. And the House has gotten, so this year, the House has something new that basically any legislator that requests that a bill filed by the deadline be put in committee will get put in committee. So there's no, it may die in committee, it may go to subcommittee, or it may not have no votes, it may go to a committee that's too tough for it, or too easy for it. But every bill does go at least to committee, so they're, I don't know, we'll maybe have a discussion about how leadership works later, but, you know, there is that. So don't always be afraid if you see a bill as in rules or assignments, because it might just have been just introduced, or it might not have gotten an extension yet. And this was just a little bit about a bill to go through how to look at a bill. And this is a bill, it was actually on food cooperatives, grocery type food cooperatives. We just did a minor change so that investors of cooperatives could, you could invest more per share to update the law. And so you can see this is a bill, it was introduced by Senator Harmon, goes to that first reading, passes out of committee, second reading, we put an amendment in, but it wasn't ready, so we tabled it, and then it went to third reading, goes over to the House. We're actually able to successfully add that amendment in the House, and it easily gets out of committee. It goes to the second reading. You know, we got the committee amendment there, and then third reading, and then it goes to concurrence. So this was a concurrence, went on to the governor, was signed. So that's the basics of how a bill works. So that was, okay. But I wanted to go to this, and then I'll go back to that last one. So that was just a little bit about how the state legislature works. And I think for the rest of this, I'm gonna go into some of the topics that we're working on. And actually I have an entire 90-minute how the state legislature works for environmentalist video that you can watch at some point. So I've got a replay that you're able to see. I didn't put in this slide witness slips, because I think the witness slips are becoming a lot more popular right now, so I wanted to talk about that. I think maybe some of you have been asked to do that in the future. So this is, again, 5 years ago, you had to have a paper witness slip, and you had to like bring it up to the committee staffer to get your opinion on record when something happened. And I often found they would just maybe like not read your committee slip even though you turned it in, or that committee slip might not make it into the bill analysis that they vote on, so legislators wouldn't see you're opposed. There's a lot of sort of hijinks that went on there. But now there's an electronic means to slip, and anybody can do it. So, you know, it was off of the ilga.gov website, and you basically go on the site, and I actually have a handout, not with me, but if anybody wants more information on exactly how to do it, but put your name, your info in, You put, if you are representing an organization, you put that in, but if you're not, you just put self in, and then you put whether you're proponent, opponent, no position, and then oral, written, or record appearance only in terms of testimony. So when we do this, we don't ask people to file witness slips on everything, because part of the problem when we do that is that if there are a ton of witness slips, they don't actually physically read it. And so like they'll just say like this electronic copy is going into the record. If there are only four or five witness slips, they'll read all of them. So we kind of make a strategic decision about whether we want a lot of people to slip or not. Because if it's a bill like, oh, like we agree with the Illinois Farm Bureau on it, and we don't want that to get lost in 50 witness slips that both the, you know, environmental groups and the Farm Bureau actually agree on this one thing for once, that might not be one where we want a whole ton of witness slips to dilute that message there. But there are other things where, you know, there's just vast citizen support and our power is in people, so we're going to want to show that. So we kind of take a, you know, we try to direct people, but of course anybody is welcome to file on things that they support. You know, if you're working with an advocacy organization, look for what their direction might be, I would say, on that, just in case it's one of those scenarios where, like I said, they want written slips read. Because if they get like 50, they'll just be like, oh, it's electronic. And if you're ever invited down to testify in Springfield, which a lot of people are, you know, the advice that I would give to you, well, first, even if you go down and you have checked oral on the testimony, and you've come to a committee hearing and you would like to speak, they don't have to allow that. So they usually only take one speaker on the opponent or proponent side. So if you're ever invited down, or if you're ever going down and you would really like to speak at a hearing, I would go talk to figure out who the committee chair is, talk to them, see if you can get added to that agenda. Sometimes they hear no testimony at all because they're very rushed and things. But they don't have to hear from people even if you check oral testimony. So try, but if you do get to speak, even then, I always advise the people that I'm working with to load all of their points in the first 30 seconds and then expand, because they may only give you a minute or 2 minutes, or even less. I've gotten the nod at a minute before, even in a panel where they were taking a lot of testimony. So, you know, just make sure you get everything you want to say really quick up front, and then expand on it, is my advice about the legislature. So now I will go into what's going on with the legislature right now. So, you know, we're really in an unprecedented situation with the state legislature, being that we are the state that's gone the longest without a real budget ever in the country. Basically, you know, the FY15 budget ended in June of 2015. We did have a stopgap budget that was the second part of 2016, but we have not had a real budget since. None of them had been balanced. A lot of unpaid bills are accruing, where it's costing us a lot of money to not have a budget, and it's a really scary situation. I know that a lot of the social services are really on the line, and you know, it's hard to talk about environmental issues when there are literally homeless people not getting services anymore, dying because of what's going on with the state budget. You know, that's really scary. But you know, it's still important for us to be advocating for all of these things, because you know, there is sufficient revenue in the state, and we should be taxing at a point that, you know, covers all of these needs. We want to see a budget that has sufficient revenue, and environmental issues are, well, in a lot of cases, they really are also about life, but also quality of life issues. And these are really important. This is not a fight between social services and the environment. We should get all of these things in the appropriate atmosphere in the state. So we put together some of the issues of concerns on our website. So there's when the stopgap budget, when the impasse first occurred, we wrote like a 4-page thing about every single thing from the budget that was impacted by the budget impasse, the cuts that the governor just did because the programs that were being cut, the ways that, I mean, literally not having a budget increases pollution, it threatens wildlife, it means, you know, less green energy. So there's a lot of things that are very severely impacted by it that you may not have heard about. And then in the stopgap budget, we also covered some of that. And I also just did another budget update that's on the front page of our website about the governor's introduced budget that was just a couple of weeks ago. But, you know, I put something out about the governor's introduced budget, but he put out a budget that literally was $4.6 billion short, and then he put in this line about how business reforms are going to save the state $4.6 billion, and so that should count as income. It's a definite fantasy there. So hopefully they all can, and if you're following really what's going on, the Senate felt that it was very close with the grand bargain that was a budget, a tax increase, and all of these other things that, some of the things that the governor wanted, like workers' compensation reform and some good government reforms, but the Senate had gotten there, but the governor called a lot of Senate Republicans and told them, you know, don't vote on this, and so it really pulled everything apart. So I just don't know how it's ever gonna get there with the parties that are in place now, but it's really hard environment to work on. So with that being said, I'm gonna go through a lot of bills that we've worked on and are gonna work on, and you know, a lot of this may just not happen this year, especially right now in the Senate because of that blow up with the grand bargain. The Senate has a sort of work stoppage, so they're not calling any bills that are not budget bills. And I don't know how long that'll go on, and you know, I don't know what influence it will have, but you know, it may hurt other pieces of legislation that need to get done. But that being said, last year there were a couple of big things that related to the environment that happened. One of them that I am really excited about, because I spent a lot of time on this bill, was a bill about lead in drinking water. And we got this one done with bipartisan support. It was difficult, but we got there in the end. And this is Senate Bill 550. It really was a response to what happened in Flint, but also what's been happening with the testing results from the city of Chicago, Waukegan, other places that are showing really high levels of lead in drinking water in schools. It's usually in school water fountains, especially because lead was allowed in pipes of different amounts up to 2012, 2014. 1987 was the cutoff for indoor pipes, but there's still some drinking water fountains that are brass lined that have some lead in it that were still built up until even just a couple of years ago. So the bill that we put together requires testing at all schools that have children under fifth grade that attend, and private, public, and they have to test every single water source that is in the school that a child might drink out of. They don't need to test like a bathroom fountain that is likely not to be consumed out of, or a janitor's closet, but they have to test kitchens, they have to test, and actually kitchens can be the worst, because if you heat up water that has lead in it, it actually makes it worse. It's one of those things that doesn't clean up. It causes increased contamination. And so we'll require all schools to test for lead. And it also, we have to write rules for it still, but it also will require child care centers to test for lead. And that's incredibly important, because the water in lead issue is more so for children under 18 months than older children, especially if you heat up baby formula with water that has lead in it. It's just about the worst thing you can do. But we also put in a couple of things where we're going to require an inventory of residential lead lines to get started, and also expands notification when there's construction of possible lead disturbances. So the other thing I'll put here, this is just the start of the work that we're doing on lead. The Environmental Defense Fund estimates that Illinois has a quarter of all lead pipes in the nation, just within Illinois. And a lot of that was because we required lead basically up until the deadline, until 1987. So it's everywhere. If you're in a home that's more than a two flat, you probably don't have lead, but I've heard about some that do. High rises usually the pipe needs to be too big to have lead, to be a lead pipe. But you know, it's basically everywhere. And while there are, you know, there's corrosion control in place that prevents the lead from getting it into average drinking water, and I will put that out, I would rather drink out of a lead-lined pipe than bottled water in terms of safety, because you know the water in there has been tested. And if you are drinking out of a lead-lined pipe, if you run the water for just a few minutes, it will coat it and it brings the lead down to zero. It is safe in that capacity, and especially compared to bottled water, where there's very little testing that goes on per batch compared to our tap water, which is very tested. But of course, you know, the very scary thing that happened in Flint. But that's where our work will go on lead in drinking water, and it's really important, but this is just the start. The other big thing, you know, there was a really big energy bill that passed last year. And energy is always a big subject, it's always controversial, it's always a compromise. There are parts of it that we are very fond of. We didn't get everything that we wanted, but in terms of the energy bill that passed, in looking at it, this energy bill, just from the actual renewable energy portions, will reduce carbon emissions by more than 50% from 2012 levels by 2030, so actually exceeding the goals of what might have been the Clean Power Plan for Illinois. And 70% of the funding in the legislation goes to wind power, solar power, and energy efficiency. And includes $750 million in programs for low-income communities. There's a really important Illinois Solar for All program that will help low-income communities access solar. It finally allows community solar. Community solar has not been allowed in Illinois. This is basically where you could put a big solar array on like this restaurant roof, and everybody could own a piece of it and get the savings benefits from owning a piece of it as well. That hasn't been allowed before. So, and then a lot of important job training programs that include program training for felons, for ex-felons, for foster children. So really some good stuff that's in there. But of course, energy bills in Springfield are often a package, and this is the one that includes the Exelon bailout, which we did not, don't like. You know, this is, I think, the most, there have been a lot of energy bills that have passed over the years, the smart grid, a lot of different things that ComEd has wanted, and it's really been a piece of what can we keep out of it. Like, this does not have anything for coal in it, which was a minor miracle, and hopefully something that we can keep out as we go ahead, because we don't want to keep any of those coal plants that are closing open. And so, you know, it is what it is. I also find that in Springfield, everything is a little bittersweet. Even when you win, you lose a little bit, or a lot. So that is some work that's going on in climate, and it's, you know, we're really proud of what was able to be in the bill, because it was really a significant amount when you look at it, the entire package. So that's the work that's being done on climate. And then I'm gonna run through just very quickly, and I have, this didn't make everything in it, but this is our spring newsletter, which actually has not been published yet. It's going to mailboxes next week, but I have some copies I printed that I put on the back if you want to read about any of these bills. So, and I'm not necessarily going to keep to this document. I got a few things I'm going to go in here. But our priorities when it has to do with the budget, you know, we're looking at protecting funding for environment and energy related agencies. We're really nervous about what's going to happen with IEPA from the federal government. There is the VW settlement money that they're going to get. That's $98 million for air pollution reduction efforts. But, you know, we don't know what will happen with water programs, air programs, et cetera, where a significant amount of money is coming from federal governments. And we've never had to worry about EPA before because they're funded by permits and fines. I mean, like, we worry about them in general, but they're funded completely by permits and fines in that general revenue fund. So, you know, they've basically been a self-funding agency, and I don't know what will happen if they're not. We just heard testimony from the Illinois EPA director Thursday, so just a couple of days ago. Their headcount is down to somewhere around the mid 600s, and they should be more at 100 more than that. So really concerning, a lot of people retiring, not being replaced. So we want to not only advocate for sufficient funding, but sufficient headcount, because we have literally cut these agencies, IEPA and IDNR, to a point where we're just not, you know, they can't really operate. So, and then the other portion that is incredibly important is the Renewable Energy Resource Fund, and this is going to be one of our top issues for the year. We, in writing the energy bill, We moved the Renewable Energy Resource Fund, which actually pays for our renewable portfolio standard. We moved it over to be basically at the utility, which is where it was before, but in a basically in a bank account at the utility that has to be mandated to be set in a certain way because it's not safe at the state. They've already swept $100 million of renewable energy funds that were supposed to go towards new renewables in Illinois, and there's a bunch of money still left in that account that if that money doesn't get allocated, it's really going to hurt the low-income solar program. So we're working really hard on making sure if there's a budget that that money actually gets appropriated and does not get stolen, because, you know, it was paid by ratepayers for the purpose of funding renewable energy. It shouldn't be going to just the general revenue fund. So that's one of our biggest priorities. Another really hot topic right now we've been working on a lot is local food production. And this is one where we get a lot of really good bipartisan support as well. So a couple of the things, just our overall goals here, you can't really read these bills, but they're in here, so I'll just tell you in general what they're about. Two of the important things that we're working on have to do with farmers markets and cottage food. And so these are basically when small producers want to make a value-added product like jams or jellies and they want to sell them, or if a farmer wants to sell things at a farmer's market. There's just varying rules and it makes it very difficult. So as an example, refrigeration is an issue for farmers markets we want to tackle this year. So if you're in Chicago and you're coming here to sell cheese, Chicago actually has really great farmers market rules. They're very supportive of the farmers here that do the farmers market. But if you want to sell cheese in Chicago, you have to follow public health rules, but you can keep the cheese in a cooler to keep it cold as long as you keep it at the right temperature. And that is enough to meet public health requirements. That is scientifically there. But if you go out to Palatine, they might not require a, not just mechanical, not just commercial, they'll require a specific industrial refrigeration unit for these local farmers' cheese. So that makes it really expensive, and you know, farmers then aren't able to sell their product, and we're not able to support sustainable agriculture. So we're trying to make it more uniform rules for farmers' markets that basically like keep it at the minimum for public health standards. And then also for cottage food, allowing a lot more products as long as there's safety glasses to be sold that are made in people's homes without industrial kitchens. I mean, they're like, this is a really difficult issue. There was, I think people may have heard about, you know, several years ago, there was a woman that wanted to make small batch ice cream out of, I think, Wicker Park or Bucktown, out of organic strawberries. And she had even a commercial kitchen she was going to operate out of, because it was small batch, there are no approved small batch procedures for ice cream in the public health code in Illinois. So she was, even though she could prove like she's bringing it up to the right temperature for pasteurization, she's keeping it there for long enough, she's keeping all the health standards in place, she was not allowed to make it because the standards in place are for industrial food, not for small batch products. So we're trying really hard. So this is one issue where we're working on deregulation. I know as environmentalists, we're always accused of over-regulating, but this is one where we're trying to get those small business owners back in. We're feeling really good about getting the Industrial Hemp Act done this year. Kentucky has allowed industrial hemp to be grown, and they have you know, over 150 farmers that are involved. We're actually working on this really hard with the Farm Bureau. They're very supportive of it, and we've kind of, you know, in the past, a lot of like Normal and some of the pot organizations have worked on industrial hemp, and we've been like, yes, you can support, but let us, you know, let us lead this with farmers and sustainable agriculture this year, and that's going to be the message. So that one is really an exciting piece of legislation. So there's a lot of good stuff going on there that I think will be helpful. And our biggest thing on conservation, there's a bill that we're trying to do to take one of the, there's a acquisition grant program through the Natural Areas Acquisition Fund that is used, has been used to buy land, but because of the bad state budget situation, we literally have not bought new conservation property since 2011, and we're 49th out of the 50 states in amount of conservation land per percent, so we're bad. But we're trying to convert some of that so we can allow stewardship grants so land trusts can pay more to take care of that property, so invasive species, prescribed burns, etc., especially while we're in this difficult budget situation. And then there's a lot we're doing with pollinator protection. There's a really cool bill that Sierra Club volunteers put together. Milkweed is a really important plant that it's basically the only thing that larvae from monarch butterflies eat. And so it's really good to plant it in a lot of places. But so there are a lot of communities that still list milkweed, native milkweed, as a noxious weed, which means that you can't grow it at all. So we are working on it. It's already gotten through the House. And Sierra Club volunteers noticed this, that they were looking at different ordinances and saw it. And it's already gotten through the House, and the bill says that no municipality can list milkweed as noxious weed. And it got through with only 2 no votes, and now it's going over to the Senate. So that one will be pretty cool. Water, our two biggest issues, you know, there was a Tribune story about livestock operations last year. We have 4 different bills on livestock operations that have been introduced that they're shell bills right now, so they don't have text. And I'm not going to tell you guys what numbers they are yet, because it's a surprise which ones they are. But we're pretty excited because we have a downstate person who is interested in sponsoring the legislation. And you know, just some really common sense reforms that livestock operations should be following anyway. Like we don't have a list of where all of the large livestock operations in Illinois are. We have no idea, no agency knows that information. And so like that's one of the things that is just a common sense fix. And then there's some work we're doing on stormwater ordinances to promote green stormwater infrastructure. There's going to be a really important resolution on environmental justice and the appropriate use of that renewable energy fund this year. And that Illinois Solar for All program is like pretty much the biggest environmental justice thing that we've got going on. We've also were thinking about amending the Environmental Justice Commission to add a couple of things to it, but I'm not sure that that'll get done this year, so that resolution is going to be the key thing there. And toxic stuff, we've been working on a ban of neonicotinoid pesticides for a while. I'm not sure that that is going to happen, but we may be able to put together a really strong pollinator protection plan, and we're working on increased training for people that use neonics. But at the city level, Alderman Lopez has an ordinance that would ban individual use of neonics, which is a really important ordinance, and I think it's going to pass. It's not going to get any opposition. And they're also looking very heavily into the city. So the city of Chicago actually barely uses any pesticides, and partially it's because they're all the money to do it. Basically, the only place they use pesticides is in killing invasive species. But they basically don't use pesticides. And so they don't use neonicotinoid pesticides that would harm monarchs or bees. But we're having them look at making sure that the plants that they buy for growth are not treated with neonics. And the other important one is the coal tar sealant ban. So this is a ban, you know, that black stuff that they put on driveways and parking lots is really toxic. And there's been a lot more research about how it gets into people's homes. It gets into sediment at the bottom of waterways and permanently contaminates them. So there's a few communities that have banned it at this point, and we actually got the bill assigned to a really good committee this year, and we're really hopeful that it can move out of committee next week, actually. So keep an eye out for that one, that'll be important. We have a ton of bills on recycling this year. The biggest thing is we're working on rewriting the electronic waste recycling law. And I think it'll make it a lot more accessible, especially for Cook County. It's been a really kind of tense negotiation, but our standard, it's not really worked very well because there's been very little enforcement of it. So there are people who just aren't recycling there's companies we suspect are not following the law, but there's just not enforcement of the current law. So we're changing from a weight-based standard to a convenience standard. So the convenience standard basically says you need to have this many pickups or this many permanent sites in each county, and the manufacturers just have to write the check for it. And that makes it a lot easier because it's like, did you do this pickup or did you not? And so it's much easier to enforce the law. But then we've got a few others on composting and recycling that are kind of minor changes, but still pretty important. But I will, this is where I'm almost done here. I will tell one story here with zero waste. And you know, like I said, one of the things that is my favorite thing to work on is when my maybe smaller environmental organizations that don't do policy, that do real program or education work, bring me bills. So one of the bills that I'm working on this year is one of my nonprofits that I work with, Scarce, in the western suburbs. They do cooking oil collection from folks and for recycling. So, you know, cooking oil is really bad to put down your drain. It can hurt your pipes, it can hurt the municipal pipes. You know, really not a good thing to put down your drain. So Scarce holds different sites that they collect cooking oil at, and they actually do a drive right after Thanksgiving when people deep fry turkeys. They'll do a drive like the Saturday afterward for people to bring their cooking oil in. But they have 8 permanent sites, and it turns out that the Dead Animal Disposal Act was amended a couple of years ago in a way that might make them have to register. So, you know, they call me all on a panic, and we did put together a bill that I think will move forward pretty easily that would exempt them from, as a nonprofit that is collecting from the public, from registration, saving them a lot of money each year. So that is exciting. And then energy, I've kind of gone through a lot of these, but PACE financing is a really big deal. And PACE financing is where you set, it's almost like setting a TIF, and I know TIFs are bad, but like it's setting a special area, and you have to both opt into the area, and you have to, as a homeowner, say you want it. And so with PACE financing, you would buy a solar panel, and you'd pay it back on either your utility bill or your property tax bill. So really important bill. But unfortunately, the governor really doesn't like special service areas, even though this isn't really a TIF, because it's sort of a double opt-in, because you both have to choose that this area is a special service area, and then as a homeowner, you have to elect to participate in the program. So it's not like a TIF where you just kind of choose the area and you have no choice about whether you're in the TIF or not. This is a double opt-in. But so they don't like, it's not really a special service area, but we had it in the special service area part of the law. So it got voted on in the House and went down. So we're going to move it somewhere else to a different chapter where we think it'll be more successful. But we pretty much have it agreed to by all parties. We just have to disassociate it from the special service area. So this is my contact information, my email, and I'm happy to, you know, anybody who wants information more on this can email me. But that is a very brief, sorry that it was so quick with some of that, but a very brief run through of all of the different things that we're working on right now, and I'm happy to take any questions.
Okay. Can you tell us a little bit about yourself and how you got involved with this environmental organization, especially since you've been working from, since you said you used to work for the legislation in Springfield?
Sure. Yeah, so I have always been interested in the environment, and I actually, even in high school, was part of my environmental club. I'm president of the environmental club, and I interned for an environmental education nonprofit in high school. But I have a bachelor's and a master's degree in environmental science, and I kind of, it's very science. I studied levels of mercury in stream water in central Illinois for my thesis. And I also have a law degree from the University of Illinois. And so I really wanted to go work for the IEPA and do enforcement. But then I found out that environmental law takes a really long time, and I don't have a lot of patience. And so the state legislature, you know, like I said, I love the deadlines, because it's very fast-paced, and it gets done or it doesn't get done. And so when I graduated from law school, I worked for Environmental Law and Policy Center for a year. And I wasn't, they're a great organization, they're wonderful. But I just wasn't liking the work that I was doing there, and I definitely knew I wanted to do more legislative work. And so for 3 years, I worked for State Senator Heather Staines when she was first elected in her district office. Very interesting experience. She actually, I mean, a lot of it was constituent services, but I also worked on a lot of legislation with her. I did some stuff on composting. I did some stuff on mental health nursing homes. So really fascinating. And then I've been at this job since 2011, so going on 7 years. It still feels like it's year 2, because I feel like we're always up against a big fight and haven't gotten what we need yet, but yeah, 7 years, seventh session.
And as a corollary, what is your stance on Pokemon Go?
So I did have something about Pokemon Go. I am at level 32 on Pokemon Go, which if you guys don't know, that's really high. I spent way too much time playing it. So one of the things that we've worked on as a bill is that in Rogers Park, and I live in Edgewater, not Rogers Park, but Kelly Cassidy contacted me because the Loyola Dunes Natural Restoration Area on it's not actually Pratt Beach, but Pratt Beach is what a lot of people call it. At Pratt Beach, there was a Pokemon Go stop put in the middle of this natural area, which you can walk on this natural area. There are paths and that sort of stuff. But this was a site at Pratt Beach. There were 300 people in a single night that were going to play Pokemon at the overall site because it's a very rare area. And so people were trampling over critical bird habitat and going over into the natural area to reach the Pokestop. And so they did some grassroots organizing, and there were probably 250 people that contacted Niantic to ask them to remove the site. They didn't, and so we introduced a bill, and that bill says that the owner or manager of any property can request the site be removed, and they have to respond. The bill is still out, and I'm actually kind of hopeful that we're going to be able to move it, because Niantic actually liked some of the language that we put together. They didn't like the time period, but they liked the language. But the day after we introduced the bill and did a press conference, they got rid of the stop. So it was gone that next day from us introducing a bill. But our point with that too, you know, we kind of like, and we did this with, you know, Jack Darren and the Sierra Club spoke a lot at the event. And, you know, the ideas of computer games, getting people outside is really exciting because it gets people into our natural areas to theoretically, you know, enjoy them, which is really great. But we do want to make sure that not just Pokemon Go, but any video games in the future that might be instructing people to go to a place, you know, that can be private property, that can be a natural area people don't belong in, it can be a historic preservation site that's not appropriate. And so asking developers to be able to remove something from the video game if requested by the site owner is really important. So it's for environmental historic preservation. So we're hopeful we can move that bill, but that was why we did that one. And we thought it was pretty important. So that was kind of a cool story brought about by local grassroots folks in Rogers Park that we were able to introduce it and make an impact right away. I mean, sometimes all you gotta do is introduce a bill, right? So, do you have a question?
Could you talk more about the Environmental Justice Commission?
Sure. So in 2011, we passed the state's first Environmental Justice Act. And I will tell you that industry organizations opposed the Environmental Justice Act just when it was a blank act with nothing in it that was called the Environmental Justice Act. They just did not like it. They thought it was not going to be good. And so the Environmental Justice Commission is an IEPA commission that looks at the environmental justice workings of the state and the state agencies. It kind of was supposed to mirror the Obama effort. Obama's environmental justice effort went beyond IEPA or USEPA. He had environmental justice looking at all other organizations too, from aging to housing, what is the pollution that low-income people are experiencing, and are we protecting all people in the same capacity was a really important question. So that's what this commission looks at. It has, I'm forgetting what the makeup of activists, but it has a lot of agencies on it, a couple of industry folks, but I think we just updated it to include 4 to 6 community members and specifically say affected communities. So we're looking at frontline communities. Kim Wasserman from Little Village Environmental Justice Organization is the chair. I think there's Dr. Sylvia Washington Hood is a professor from the suburbs who's on it. So and then there's a lawyer who's on it, Keith Harley from IIT. So good work, but hard. So.
I'm sure you talked about it before. What's the structure all along here? You're with Illinois Environmental
Council.
Which you fall. Can you talk about the structure of the 60 organizations under you, and who is the agency that is above you, and the one that's below you, and who you report to? Shut up!
So, I mean, we're a C3, C4. You know, we're a nonprofit, and I have a board of directors. The board of directors is made up of groups like, I mean, they're membership dues that you have to pay to be part of the organization. But we, you know, like we often waive them for smaller community organizations because we really want their involvement. But the Sierra Club, Energy, actually, I think in this, you can see who the ISC board of directors is if you look at it in the handout I have back there. And it's got the organizations Faith in Place, Isaac Walt, Lead, the Nature Conservancy. So that's our board. But the board doesn't really, it doesn't really make policy decisions. They more, like, make sure we're raising enough money and that sort of stuff. But in terms of, like, how we make decisions, our 80 different environmental organizations are, we do, like, phone calls every week during the legislative session. Well, so I should say we have a policy platform that our individual members and our member organizations adopt at our December meeting every year. So that policy platform is like, just in case we have to make a really quick decision, like we can make it based on like, oh, we do support recycling and there's a recycling bill up, Chen can really quickly make that decision. Or we support prairie burning and we can support that legislation if there's anything very quick, because sometimes Springfield is a disaster.
You know, I was just wondering how the structure is. As far as you're just a separate entity,
yeah,
not related to the state, not funded by the state.
No, we don't get any government money.
The 60 groups that are part of you, who are they? And
so yeah, it just ranges from
the structure.
Yeah, no, just in our other environmental organizations are part. We have some governmental groups, but those organizations are they're small organizations, like little. Well, they're not so. People for Community Recovery out of Elko Gardens is a member, for example, or the Elgin Community Organization, ECO, their environmental group. So we have very small organizations,
yeah,
and then groups like the Sierra Club, et cetera, on our board. So it's...
They're members, too,
yeah,
of your organization,
yeah, so,
and you get some funding or what,
yeah,
have you from them.
Yeah, so they help pay because we essentially,
yeah,
serve as their lobbyists.
I'm sorry, it's like,
oh,
follow,
no, no,
the money stuff. You,
yeah,
know,
yeah,
it always works in,
yeah, no, and if
business
you,
and politics.
If you want to look, I mean, like, a lot of our C3 money is from foundations. We do get some corporate donations, but we have,
good,
you can look at the policy on our website. We have a, it's public and it's, you know, we don't accept corporate contributions that are, the public doesn't know about. So, like, they have to be, like, a sponsor of an event. They can't just give us money. So you would know that we would get that money from them. So, for example. So that's some of the ethics things that we do to make sure that we're, you know. But mostly, but we get, our C4 is mostly funded by our members.
Okay, thanks for explaining that.
Yeah,
yeah, that was important.
Of course it's important.
What's,
I mean,
a council? It's so hard,
yeah,
to figure out. I don't know what a council is.
A lot of people, it's a wigwam, Charlie.
Well, and I'm happy
Charlie
to, like,
know
you know, our financials are pretty public.
That's
so,
a lot of people,
you know,
Charlie, don't know that.
Go ahead.
Okay, I know in the last couple of years they were storing some sort of refinery byproduct on the grounds over there in the southeast,
okay,
side,
yeah,
of the city. What, I haven't heard anything lately. Was there any kind of bill passed to prevent that from happening, or
no?
What do you know about it?
So, and actually, it's hit the news again because of the manganese issue, because they're like, oh, the poor southeast side. But you know, I've been very proud of the Southeast Environmental Task Force. Is one of my favorite groups to work with because they're both a community organization protecting their community, but they have done. We gave them an award a few years ago because they have also gone to Springfield and successfully advocated for things to protect their community, because they just, it's almost like they're in a war zone with all of that pollution and contaminants there and the other things that, like, you know, the residents want this to be a clean, livable community, but industry wants to come in. But so with Petco, there were regulations passed by the city of Chicago. The community activists do want the Petco banned, but you know, like, it hasn't gotten quite there yet. But they've at least I'm not sure what the specific rules were, but there were rules to put in place in the city to protect it. We tried to pass the state law, and the people who live by the Petco pile outside of Alton apparently don't care, you know, so not like the people themselves, but, you know, the government officials, for example, they don't want the same rules that we would have in the city of Chicago to be in Alton. And so it was just incredibly hard to get anything done in Springfield. I mean, that's the thing to think about, too. Like, we're here in the city, and, like, I mean, you know, even though we have Democratic supermajorities, people may think, like, oh, the legislature's going to be in the environment. They're not. I mean, you know, we do the best that we can to advance, but, you know, there are just a lot of people that are not supportive of environmental issues, and especially downstate Democrats. So that can be really difficult. But yes, there was progress at the city level with Petco, and now there's some work being done on manganese. I believe that the company that is doing the bad stuff with manganese just filed a plan to deal with the dust, and the city just told them no, which is like, okay, thumbs up, city, that was a good idea. But there have been some rules, but there's still work being done on that issue. It's getting, you know, it's from tar sands. So, getting it worse. But did you have a question?
I think he did.
Do you think the Republicans will cut the EPA on a national level?
Well, I mean, you know, I'm not as good with federal predictions, but I mean, I think that they're going to try to do as much as they can with dismantling the US EPA. But I mean, like, just environment and keeping, you know, your quality of life clean is really not a partisan issue. When it comes down to it, you know, they want to do all of these things at the federal level, but if they're doing it, we look at what people support, and we look at, you know, people want clean water, people want clean air, people want clean energy, and not just a little bit, like vast majorities of people support this. So, I mean, the only thing that I can think is, you know, the more they do this junk where they're dismantling the US EPA and they're destroying things over on this level, you know, the more they're separating themselves from where the public is at. And so that, you know, if we're going to win there, that's a good thing. But I am very nervous about what's going to happen at the federal level. And so I think it's really important at the state level to you know, try to keep some of those protections in place. Like I said, I didn't bring this one up, but we have been working on advancing a lead shot ban, because there was a lead shot ban that was rescinded immediately for the U.S. and Fish and Wildlife Service properties.
Yeah.
And we have been working on advancing one in the Senate that I think we're going to get out, despite strong NRA objections to it. I don't know why they want to kill bald eagles, but you know, that's lead shot. But so we're trying to do what we can. And I think the local First level Amendment, and the state level are incredibly important as we go through this to make sure that we're keeping people protected. So,
he has a question, for me.
If you let your water run, does it clear it out, or does it keep my cover?
So, well, this is the chemistry. If you have a lead, he has a question about lead pipes and, you know, what happens if you clear. So the chemistry, what happened with Flint, you know, there are so many lead pipes everywhere that almost every water system in the country puts corrosion control into our water. And so it's usually a chemical called orthophosphate. And when water is flowing, that orthophosphate coats the pipes and makes sure that there is no corrosion. And so if your water is sitting, if you have lead pipes, you let your water sit there for a long time. Yeah. That's why they tell people to flush it for like 5 minutes, because the corrosion control will come in and coat the pipe when you flush the water. Yeah. So, I mean, I wouldn't want to drink water out of lead pipes that has just been sitting there. I mean, one of the advice, you know, with a water fountain, one of the water people gave me this advice that I think is good, which is like, if you're going to a public water fountain, run it. I mean, and I hate wasting water, but especially with, you know, the Park District has some really high lead levels. Run it until it's cold, because if it's cold, that means that it's been run. But if it's warmer water, that means that it may have sat there for a bit. So that's one of the pieces of advice he gives for drinking out of public water fountains. But yeah, we don't want to waste water, but
like house water.
Water always stays in water. like the house water. I let it run until it's real cold.
You don't know anything
yeah.
about
then
water.
It's cleared enough.
I know yeah. water.
You know, you're an oil man.
Sorry, do you want to?
I just wanted to mention, you know, kind of follow up. The community out on the southeast side has been very, very effective in terms of what they've been doing. And it was a positive thing that the Chicago Department of Public Health did say, you know, the I think it's S.H. Bell company's plan was not adequate. But, you know, the corporations like Bell, British Petroleum, Koch Brothers, etc., you know, are devastating the southeast side of the city and the adjacent areas in Indiana. And it just seems like there's a real lack in public life, you know, for reasons that are understandable but not acceptable, that the corporations do not get overtly criticized by people who are in authority positions. You know, in other words, Department of Public Health, which I think was a real positive thing, saying, that this plan isn't good enough. That's unusual. But you never hear criticism of the corporations themselves and the fact that they're essentially sociopathic. Why do you think that is something which is not occurring?
I mean, like, I know that when we were doing the work on the Petcoke issue, we were bringing up the Koch brothers a lot and the two facilities in Springfield. I mean, I know that the activists are doing, I think you are right in terms of elected officials. I don't know why that's not being brought up in a broader context. So.
Well, I mean, you know, and I don't know that your organization, given how it's structured and everything, is in a position to do anything. But unless those corporations are shamed by people who are authority figures, like politicians, it's very, very difficult to get them to change. You know, I was out at some of those meetings and been active with the Southeast Side Coalition, you know. And everybody gets sucked into this thing with lawyers. You know, like where, we'll bring a lawsuit and then something will happen. And by the time anything gets resolved, if it does, a lot of people have been hurt.
It takes a long time. A
couple years passed by.
It's a joke. And so, you know, I would just say to you from your point, you know, your position, talking to people, you really got to do that. Otherwise, they don't respond.
Yeah, that's good advice. I'm just trying to think where I can use some of it. Because, you know, we're often like for example, when we pass a positive bill, you know, we try to not be like, this bill is, like, we don't support bills that would help any one company, for example, any one solar company. So we try to, in our bills, you know, like it's general good policy. You know, we're not supporting a business, it might be a category, but I don't know I think there's a little bit, like we were doing some air pollution stuff a while ago, we talked about some of the state's biggest polluters by name. But yeah, you know, you're right, that's some good advice, so thank you. Go ahead.
Finally. Come on.
I have
about two, three questions, but we had a little dictator in front, and a guy from Argon Laboratories was talking about a subject, and I wanted to ask a question. I was overruled.
You know that a little dictator?
Concerning tap water, and bottled water. The guy from Margaret Laboratory, he brought out about five bottles, and I agreed with him. I read that actually you are buying tap water. However, there is one bottle that I will take issue with, and that's distilled water. The lead will not evaporate the same way water evaporates.
Yeah, so you have to filter it.
Yeah,
but not a lot of bottled water is distilled.
Right. Oh, you actually, they are labeled distilled, and
yeah.
Hopefully they are when I buy them.
Yeah.
Because
yeah.
I'm a strong proponent to distilled water.
Yeah, well, filtration, I should have brought that up. You know, because that was one of the things with schools, too, is that a lot of these things are easy to fix because you can flush the water, you can put a filter on it, you can turn the fountain off. So, yeah.
So you're in favor of distilled water as compared to other bottled water?
What a great question to ask me. I mean, I really don't, like if it was an aluminum bottle, maybe. I just don't think plastic gets recycled enough. So maybe if you're recycling your plastic.
Okay, right.
But filtration on your tap.
Give him another one.
Distilling your tap water yourself, best option.
Yeah.
Distilling it yourself, oh boy.
Well, you can put a filter on there.
I would need something like this.
There's a total lead. There are total lead filters you can put on your tap.
Yeah, but some chemicals are not filtered, really, you know, because they are so small, you know, on molecular level. Even though they promoted us being filterable, but it's not. One other thing, you mentioned a point here that really caught my eye, and it's you said that the bills are read to the legislator 3 times. Oh wow! Then why did that doesn't apply? One thing. Okay, so we can vote for an illiterate because after all, the bills are going to be read. Then why Michael Moore was there with a form in national?
Actually, I don't even have any more.
Congress.
And
say, okay, I'm here to read the bills for you because he was claiming that many of them.
Oh, so that's the federal government. The state government. So and even when the state government reads a bill 3 times, they read the title. They don't read like the entire bill. And so they just have to read the title into the record 3 times to meet constitutional considerations. At the Illinois Constitution, not the U.S.
Just one word, if possible. What is the success for the indigenous people to win their case against the pipelines?
You know, I don't know. I was just watching actually that the commercial on it that they just put together. Pipelines are real hard. I mean, Ray can tell you, pipeline work. We actually did a, we had an attorney look at pipeline laws and like, basically, Illinois is prohibited from doing anything about pipelines whatsoever, except like taxing it. We have the insurance requirements we're looking at, but like we can't specify a building material or specify a well. Like that is controlled by the federal government, and including like the siting of it. There's very little that the state of Illinois actually can do. There's some other stuff with our eminent domain laws that are kind of complicated, but like pipelines in Illinois, which there are a lot of, basically the only thing you can do is tax it. We actually had a bill written once that would have taxed pipelines and made it pay for emergency services in the area, which I thought was a good bill, but other people did not.
What about the easement rule? Easement rule.
Well, so the eminent domain stuff.
Yeah,
this will be the last, and then I'll take charge. The eminent domain on Illinois eminent domain is a touchy subject too, because the ICC basically has to grant what they've asked for. It's kind of the same with some of our permits that you know, like the response has to be yes if they meet certain requirements. You can't say no to it, and so the ICC basically has to say yes to the things that are put in front of it to follow the law. There's some issues overall with how development is done in Illinois that is similar. So there's really very little the state can do about pipelines. So it has to be done at the federal level. So we'll see. But Charlie, do you have a question?
Yeah, I realize this also is at the federal level, but everyone here in this room is going to go home, go to sleep tonight. And a 33,000-gallon tank car train is going to pass by their house. Is there anything out of Springfield regarding crude oil tank cars?
Well, so trains are another thing that are difficult to regulate at the state level. But
it's interstate commerce.
Yeah, it's interstate commerce, and so the state regulates trains. But we've been looking at, especially with regard to the southeast side, whether there's anything you can do about particulate matter that comes from trains. So, like, can you require that trains that go through the city not be open car? Because there's a lot of particulate matter from some of those, which can be really dangerous. Yeah. So there's not a lot, but we're always looking for different little clever ways that we can, you know, make the difference. But that's another trains and pipelines. That sort of stuff is very federal. There's, you're just not even allowed to do stuff in the state sometimes.
Most important question of the night: Cubs or Sox fan?
North Sider.
All right.
I like Illinois. Illinois is a great state.
Okay.
We got
okay.
Here.
Good enough.
Not the Cardinals, though. Sorry.
Ooh.
Sorry.
Hi, Jennifer. Instead of running the tap water, like you had mentioned a few minutes, do you recommend using lead filters instead of running your water a few minutes before drinking?
Yeah, that is really the best idea, and you can. You can really get lead filtration, lead filters for very inexpensive, and you know maybe $50 for buying in, $25 for the replacement. So yeah, that gets all the lead out. You have no worries when you get the filter on.
How about we?
Yeah, you can buy some that you just put at the end of your faucet and turn it on, and there's ones with the filter where you can like. There's a switch that you can make it just run normal tap water, like if you're watering your plants or something, and then you can switch it to put the filter on. So there's some really innovative things there with filtration. So.
All right. How about where you buy it?
Hardware stores?
Yep. Hardware stores, Target.
Okay. Oh, you just put it on the end and just close it.
Yeah, okay. They have to be specifically lead.
It has to say total lead.
Right. They can't be any type of filter.
It can't just be a Brita, but there are some Brita that do total lead.
Okay.
So you just have to look for it.
There's a filter, you wash it out, or
you put a new filter in. So it's like, but there's a piece you'll buy to put on the faucet, and then you only have to replace like the carbon,
okay.
The piece that goes inside of it, top of it, the cartridge.
You ready for rebuttals, Andy?
How often do you change it?
Oh, do you have a question?
Yeah, I caught the end part of your. I caught the end part of your Dapple pipeline explanation.
Uh-huh.
So there's nothing going on as far as Illinois is concerned, the Dakota Access Pipeline.
I mean, there are people doing things, but there's not anything that the state can do. There's a pipeline insurance bill that the Sierra Club's working on that, I mean, and this is an issue overall, is making sure that like companies don't self-bond with insurance. In general, but the insurance bill has to do with requiring environmental cleanup insurance. So if you have a problem, you have money to pay for the cleanup.
Because is that going to be a new pipeline underneath the Mississippi? I haven't read about that. It's coming.
And where is it? I don't know. Dapple's
coming to Illinois.
Yeah, there's part of it in Illinois. Part of Dapple is in Illinois.
And if it is underneath the Mississippi, that's you know, an issue. If they have a leak.
Yeah, no, it's a concern.
Yeah.
So. All right. Well, I think those are the questions.
You got rebuttals next. Let's thank our speaker. All right, Andy, you want to go ahead and get the rebuttal drill going?
Let's have a show of hands. See how many people want to give a rebuttal. Keep your hands up so we can count. One, two, three. So there's only four people that want a rebuttal. Charlie's five. Six, seven. Okay. With the time we have, try to do 4 minutes.
Okay.
Each for a rebuttal. Okay.
Yeah, 4 minutes should be plenty of time.
Well, we'll be a little lenient, but well, the target is 4 minutes each, so that'll it'll push us to 8:35, more or less, by the time everybody is through.
Okay.
Thank you very much to the speaker for an excellent presentation. I'll just start off with this poem. Urge the governments be done with this foolishness, and our steps will find lasting roads. Purge the pollutants from the harvest, and our next will taste like home. Release the betterment from moneyism, and our best we will know. Free the environment from the market, and the rest will follow. David Suzuki and many other world-renowned environmentalists met in Rio de Janeiro in 1992 for an Earth Summit, and they wrote a Declaration of Independence for Planet Earth. And it says, it follows that whatever we do to the planet, we do directly to ourselves. And in that Declaration of Independence, at the end, he said, and I encourage everybody to go to the David Suzuki Reader to read this. It's a great book. A Lifetime of Ideas from a Leading Activist and Thinker, it's called. They said, this we resolve. All this that we know and believe must now become the foundation of the way we live. At this turning point in our relationship with Earth, we work for an evolution from dominance to partnership, from fragmentation to connection, from insecurity to interdependence. And that's easier said than done. But some industrialized countries are prioritizing it because they know there's no choice now. We're at the 23rd hour. And that's why it's so frustrating on a statewide level, on a national level, that we see a lot of fanatically unreasonable people making these decisions. This is just a poll in the February 23rd Rolling Stone. It says, American values by the numbers, what Americans believe. 64% significantly are worried about global warming. 41% believe it will pose a serious personal threat in our lifetimes. And this is a very interesting statistic. Trump voters, 61% of Trump voters require companies to reduce carbon emissions. And 55% uphold or strengthen Obama climate change policies. What's sad about that is Trump's position. He called to abandon the Paris Climate Agreement. You know, eliminate the harmful and unnecessary policies, as he's termed them, of the last administration's climate action plan. Cuts emissions and supports resiliency projects. The last time something so crucially important, not just the liberty of some of the people, but survival likelihood to all the people on Earth occurred, there was fearlessness to speak, to think, to discuss, to write, to brainstorm, to problem solve, to assemble, to protest, to voice dissent, and to put an end to being ruled by fanatically unreasonable individuals and declare autonomy. It's up to us. Trump's daring us to be great in our definition of greatness. Let's show him what our definition of greatness is before it's too late.
Yeah. 4 minutes.
Yeah, you guys are getting so
nobody. 4 minutes.
Everybody else gets hungry in 4 minutes.
Oh. We just started the clock.
Where did everybody go? Bring them back in here. They go to Target.
They heard you were coming.
They heard you were coming.
All right, you want me to do my Sean Spicer? All right, anyway, thanks for the speech. Good to hear. We have many, many environmental organizations in Illinois. And I'm surprised, I'm shocked at all these. Can I get the list of those 60? Because okay, good. Do you have a card?
80?
I think you get your card.
I got a card.
Okay. And good to see. I'm surprised you didn't know that water is, you can't waste water. Water is a substance that, H2O, as you all know, that never leaves the planet Earth. That glass is water's millions of years old, and that glass of water will be here for millions of years. Now, coal and oil will burn up and evaporate and become pollution. I almost got an environmental master's degree myself, but, they kicked me out.
Good reason.
So anyway, just so you know, the biggest environmental problem in the state of Illinois right now, and I know people get worried about lead, just, you know, just everybody drink, put on your water for a couple seconds and clear out the pipes and you're fine. The biggest environmental problem in the state of Illinois is O'Hare Airport. It burns billions and billions of gallons of oil and jet fuel every year, and politicians one by one will be getting fired and kicked out of office as we move forward. It's O'Hare's capacity now is massive, and I'm not even talking about noise pollution and oil use, but so I would like eventually to have a dollar, a bill that comes up, a dollar a passenger tax to build out the New York, sustainable New York Chicago bullet train. It will use sustainable power as Illinois goes to solar more, to wind power and other sustainables. Jet fuel, there's no way in hell you can have that as, there's no way you can have emissions controls. It's just pure pollution. So, we're in one of the big flight paths, and the noise and in the carcinogens and the pollution coming from O'Hare is massive.
Right over this restaurant.
So that's right. The biggest problem today in Illinois is the O'Hare pollution. Thank you.
All right, next.
All right, I'm Dan Bader. I want to reiterate something I've stated up here a few times. You know, we're now in exponential, abrupt climate change. It's only been going on for a few years. I think they started to recognize it back in maybe around 2007. So what does that mean? From 1750 to about October of 2015, the temperature, the average temperature, went up approximately 1 degree Celsius. They used 1750 as baseline when the Industrial Revolution started. So that's 1 degree up to October 2015. From October 2015 to about the end of 2016, it went up anywhere from 0.20 to about 0.50, depending on who you're listening to. Whether it's just 0.20, this is exponential. It's really taking off. So I think it would, Dennis, was saying earlier about Michael Mann, who's a well-known climatologist from Penn State. We have Peter Wadhams, who was from Cambridge. And they're basically saying at this point, and a lot of others are starting to speak up, they're losing their fear because it's so pressing, that you have to have geoengineering interventions such that you actually take the greenhouse gases out of the air and sequester it successfully. If you don't do that, you're looking at, you have to keep in mind, if we're at, let's say we're at about 1.5 right now. When it gets to be 3 degrees Celsius, somewhere between 3 and 4, you're not going to be able to sustain habitat that will support the human species. That's something that people need to take in. It's very unpleasant because the idea that in a few years, some people say, you know, within a decade, that's where you're going to be. And you're not going to be able to survive, and all these other things become minimized in terms of importance. The fact that Trump believes, you know, nothing is going on is almost amusing. Because at some point, you know, he's going to have to learn and others are. But people need to become active and understand that global warming is exponential. You can follow the data yourself. All you have to do, you can use a website like Arctic News or just go ahead on the internet and explore. But all you have to do is let's see it, you know, at the end of 2017, what's the temperature? Has it gone up another 0.30? That's really bad news, or more. And you can also monitor whether the Arctic is going to go ice-free this year in the summer. It's coming up. If that happens, the heating is going to start to really accelerate from where it's at even now. So we got to get very active and demand that something is done before it's too late. Thank you.
Okay, Dennis.
They're talking about it.
All right, Dennis, 4 minutes.
My name is Dennis Nelson. Jen, thanks for your presentation on Civics for Environmentalists. I get the IEC Enviro Bulletin and your action alerts. And I've been making a difference on environmental topics in Springfield for years. For example, I supported the Preventing Lead in Drinking Water Bill, SB 550, that you mentioned. This requires the basic steps to be taken to protect children from lead pollution. I am wearing my t-shirt from the lobby day in Springfield for the Illinois Clean Jobs Bill on last year's Earth Day, April 22nd. However, the Future Energy Jobs Bill, SB 28814, passed during the legislative veto session is a mixed blessing because it included the Exelon nuclear bailout. And I covered this when I spoke here on December 17th of last year. I'm a longtime member of the Nuclear Energy Information Service, NEIS, Illinois Nuclear Power Watchdog Group. I received this from Beyond Nuclear, one of the brother and sister groups that NEIS works with in the Washington, D.C. area. It's dated December 12th of last year. It's entitled Trump Transition Team's Questionnaire to DOE Foreshadows Catastrophic Energy Agenda, Pro-Nuclear Power and Fossil Fuels, Anti-Climate and Renewables Efficiency. The long list of the Trump Transition Team questions to the U.S. Department of Energy leaves no doubt that Donald Trump plans a sweeping pro-nuclear power policy. Question number 53 especially pertains to this evening's discussion of the Exelon nuclear bailout. And I'm quoting question number 53 and Beyond Nuclear's analysis, quote, 53, what can DOE do to help prevent premature closure of plants? 4 failing old reactors in upstate New York and 3 aged, degraded, uncompetitive reactors in Illinois have been bailed out at ratepayer expense to the tune of $7.6 billion and $2.35 billion, respectively. The reactors otherwise would have closed in the near future, but now they're ever more dangerous operations. The reactors are deep into their breakdown phase of increasing safety risks, have been extended by years or even decades. Tim Judson of NIRS, N-I-R-S, has estimated that should New York and Illinois-style bailouts for old reactors take place across the United States, the cost to ratepayers could exceed $280 billion, unquote. NIRS stands for the Nuclear Information Resource Service, another brother and sister group in the Washington, D.C. area that NEIS works with. Nuclear reactors that are too costly should be shut down, period, without any ratepayer bailouts. A recent case in point is the Fort Calhoun Nuclear Station in eastern Nebraska along the Missouri River. The board of the Omaha Public Power District, OPPD, the owner of Fort Calhoun, voted unanimously on June 16th of last year to permanently close the nuclear station by the end of that year. On October 24th, 2016, Fort Calhoun was shut down for good. Good, no nukes. And what was the reason given by the OPPD board? Because Fort Calhoun was too expensive as compared with the alternatives. Energy efficiency, solar power, and wind electricity are all more cost effective. Well, I can boast and brag about my role in shutting down Port Calhoun with a P by helping to get the ball rolling. NEIS renamed the Fort Calhoun nuclear station Port Calhoun with a P. This is because of the 2011 Missouri River floods that surrounded the plant with flood water and forced it to be taken offline for over 2.5 years. I am alumnus of Dana College, a 4-year liberal arts school in Blair, Nebraska. Oh, we're 4 minutes already. Glad to just finish. Let's finish. Okay.
Okay.
It's in the vicinity of the Fort Calhoun Station. And I was in the Dana College's Biology Environmental Studies Department. I testified before the United States Atomic Energy Commission, USAEC, in favor of denying Fort Calhoun its operating license. After graduating in 1976, I joined forces with the No Nukes activists in Omaha, Nebraska. I lived across the river, the Missouri River, in Council Bluffs, Iowa. I was a member of the Nebraska Mobilization for Survival that became the Breadbasket Alliance after the beginning of Three Mile Island on March 28, 1979. As the Breadbasket Alliance energy analyst and resource person, I had several public debates with an OPPD chemical and metallurgical engineer. In our exchange of letters to the editor in the Omaha World Herald, he claimed that alternate energy is a cruel hoax, and that was a bogus claim even back then. Well, who ought to be right? Efficiency, solar, and wind are also now more more economical, less expensive than Exelon's three bailed out nuclear reactors. Thank you.
Yeah.
Oh, boy.
Okay.
Yeah.
My turn.
My turn. Yeah. He's got some thorium,
Benson. Yeah. That's right, Charlie. The thorium nonsense that you keep talking about. I agree completely with Dennis that the present way we do nuclear power is ineffective, is inefficient, and was also chaired by a gentleman by the name of Alvin Weinberg, one of the designers of the light water reactors, who in 1972 was fired from his post at Oak Ridge Laboratory because he started proponing views of nuclear reactor safety, global warming. But what Alvin Weinberg did was come up with an alternative to the way we do nuclear power now. And he spent the 1960s developing something called the molten salt reactor, which is a better way of doing nuclear power because you don't have the high pressure water. You use salts as a coolant, and it's just generally much, much safer. Now, for those of you who do not like nuclear power, according to Richard Martin, author of a book called Superfuel, this revolution is going to happen. Whether it be here or overseas. China right now has a panel of about 300 scientists working on the commercialization of a thorium molten salt reactor system. And believe it or not, once these things get up and running, you could have a building about the size of this restaurant powering the entire north side of the city of Chicago with about a basketball-sized waste after 30 years. Plus, you can burn up and recycle much of the nuclear waste that we have sitting at our existing nuclear facilities. Plus, you know, we could build these things in mass production in factories where they would be much safer for deployment and move on. You may wonder, why am I such a proponent of thorium molten salt reactors and alternatives to energy? Because I happen to know that renewables and other forms of energy just aren't going to produce enough power. And when the wind don't shine and the sun doesn't, and the wind doesn't blow, you're basically using natural gas as a backup source. And we all know that, much like cars, when they're in city traffic, get a lot less mileage, so does a natural gas plant. If it's running continuously and throttling just a little bit, you have a lot less emissions out of a natural gas plant than when you would have actually more emissions out of that same plant when it's hooked up to renewable power. I am not against renewable power. I think solar panels and wind is a good thing. And instead of trying to fight each other, we should be working on solutions. Also, like conservation, I like things. But the point of the matter is, we will need power to run an advanced industrial society. And if you really want recycling to really kick in, you cheapen the power of electricity more, not just to recycle aluminum, but steel and other things. We've only begun to scratch the surface of recycling. And we can do that, but it's going to require cheap and abundant power. And I believe the only way that's going to happen is through nuclear.
Okay.
If you don't believe me, take a look at Richard Stone's movie called Pandora's Promise. Thank you.
We got another movie you might like to watch called Chernobyl.
We have to hang up for a rebuttal.
Come on, get up there and get rebuttal. Charlie!
Oh, my turn?
Get up there, Charlie!
Give a second.
Get up there, Charlie! Blow me out of the water, Charlie!
Alright, let's thank our speakers here. Really, it was very nice.
Yes.
Really, very informative. I do lobbying at the federal level and limited on the state and local level, but it was good to get informed of what the Greens are doing. I've been affiliated with the Chicago Greens for quite a few years, since their inception just about. Let's see, I'll be eclectic as usual here. But on March 25th, by the way, I'll advertise the Chicago Cook County Greens, the Illinois Green Party. We're having a little bit of an annual powwow. That'll be on the west side at one of the libraries by the Blue Line. For once, Mike, I are in agreement with transportation. If anything, the Illinois Council, if you could look more towards transportation, we have a system that is 97% oil-dependent transportation system in the nation, and we've got to do something to alter that. The feds, nothing's going to happen there. The House in particular is completely, totally, and absolute under control of the coal, oil, and gas guys. Those boys control everything.
Good, we'll kick them out.
And they're very serious. You have no idea how intense they are, and it's strongly, intensely averse to even the slightest ecological legislation. Even amazing. They were even said they possibly should do something to attract younger voters. They said hell no. They wouldn't. They thought that it would be an edge for the party. They still said no. We're not having anything to do with this. So it's going to be a pretty dark situation. The other thing I'd like to mention, you're talking about the Petco. I actually testified to the city of Chicago on Petco. And if you go to the Chicago Greens website, I think it's still at the bottom. We have that Petco song. We had a song about how bad Petco was. But anyhow, it's good to learn. Get involved in the Illinois Council. By the way, where's that? Oh, there he is. Here's that thorium guy on the 6th anniversary of the. I just posted how this is what he wants to do. Within 6 years, this is amazing. This is the map I did.
And you're talking about a light water reactor, Charlie.
I sent a map around where they detected that the.
I have no shame.
The nuke boys have contaminated the entire Pacific Ocean.
Yeah.
And everything in it.
Salmon.
And you're actually proposing you want to do more of this.
It That's right, Charlie. The largest reactor.
Single contamination in the history of mankind. And he says, this is a good idea. Let's do more of it.
It is a good idea with safer reactors, Charlie.
How could you pollute the entire Pacific Ocean and then recommend, oh, let's do this again? Thank you very much.
That's because the reactor was in the office.
Hello, environmental. Here you go.
All right. Andy, I got your time here on the thing.
Okay.
When you're ready.
Well, first of all, I brought a book. An extra copy of this. Maybe we might give away copies of this thing on during Dennis's talk coming up in April.
Okay.
It's called The Cult of the Atom. It was written 30 years ago. People that promote atomic energy are part of a religious type cult. They believe things that have no basis in reality. Second, the idea that you could use high temperature corrosive salts, highly corrosive salt as a coolant in a nuclear power plant, is basically a religious belief that has no basis in reality. It was proved to be totally unworkable almost 40 years ago. That's why the technology was abandoned. So we have to help our less informed friends understand that promoting any kind of nuclear power in the modern age leads to what Amory called the spread of nuclear material that can be used to make bombs, period. That was solid 30 years ago. If we're going to get rid of nuclear weapons, we have to shut down the nuclear power industry. Okay, a few things that the media doesn't cover that if you help your friends and neighbors learn, we can all move forward. Number one, today, as in right after the election of 2000, the American United States has no president. For 8 years, we had two corporate criminals, Bush and Cheney, who lost the election both times and were installed for the purpose of shoveling money to billionaires and putting criminals in charge of the U.S. government. That crime wave was voted out in 2008 in a massive landslide. So for 8 years, President Obama basically tried to pick up the pieces and acted as a placeholder until the criminals could take over again. So Trump, it's common knowledge among analysts now that Trump lost the election by any way you slice it, and he was installed with massive voter suppression and changing vote totals in computers after we went to bed. Trump is the first, in modern times, he's the first president the first person to enter the Oval Office with massive criminal background and all kinds of things that make him totally unfit to be the President of the United States. And there's a growing movement among both conservative Republicans and Democrats to impeach and remove him. The second thing the media is not covering, a report came out, I'll have more copies of it probably next week or the week after. Solar power is now recognized as providing more good-paying jobs, the solar industry, than coal, oil, gas, or nukes. And it is growing by leaps and bounds. The U.S. military, number three, the U.S. military considers global warming and climate change to be the number one greatest threat facing the United States. It's not international terrorism. The idea that the military is off fighting terrorists is a big, giant myth promoted by the military-industrial complex to keep the trillion-dollar-a-year budget going.
Yeah. Yeah.
Number four, I'd like to mention the mainstream media. Donald Trump has one thing correct, but for the wrong reason. The mainstream media is worthless about trying to keep the public informed on what's really going on. The mainstream media's job is to maintain the media, maintain Americans in a bubble of ignorance and mythology. If Americans really know what's going on, they will get more involved, like the million women or so wearing the pink hats in the march right after Trump got elected. More and more people are waking up and protesting, realizing what Bernie Sanders said. We need a movement like a World War II mobilization on climate change and a mobilization to shut down the criminal takeover of our government. And the only thing that's going to do that is people waking up, helping their friends learn. There's three websites I like to mention. Common Dreams, this is a news site that gives you the best of the best every day. Another one is called Truth Out, and a third one is called The Smirking Chimp. Those three have authors that have been writing books like this for the last 35, 40 years. These people with credibility contribute articles daily to those three sites, and then they go viral out to hundreds of other sites all over the world.
Okay.
So if anybody wants any information on any of that, see me afterwards. And again, thanks to our speaker for a beautiful presentation tonight.
Hey, speaker gets the last word. Speaker gets the last word.
Last word.
Yes.
Oh, on
I'm going to be real quick because I just had a few things. Thanks for having me out again, and thanks for all of these comments. I learned some things too, but I had three specific things I wanted to respond to. I thought, your comment, Charlie, about the transportation, it's definitely a thing I wish we were doing more work on. Part of the issue is that a lot of transportation issues now are about funding, and so dealing with that in this budget climate, really hard. Although we did, we are supporting a bill that would require employers in the RTA area to offer the transit benefit, that is from the federal government, require people to be able to sign up for the tax-free dollars, so that would be big, but transit, totally. I don't know, my organization does oppose nuclear power, but I do want to bring up that some of, sometimes there are issues brought up about the intermittency issues about solar and wind. We are a long way off from those intermittency issues being real. We can absorb a lot more solar and wind. And I think the biggest argument for solar and wind right now is that they are intensely cheaper than anything else we can be doing. So building those up to the highest point that we can is good for jobs, it's good for cheap power, it's good for the environment. So really important. And while you're right, we can't run out of water, we can run out of clean water, and aquifers everywhere are being depleted. California, the Middle East, a lot of conflicts in the Middle East are actually around water. I mean, I know oil is a part of it, but not having water is a really important issue. Illinois has a lot of water. We actually drain it off in some places. But there's still aquifers in Illinois that are severely depleted. And are those people going to take from Lake Michigan? Are we going to give Lake Michigan water to California and destroy habitat there? So running out of clean water, real big problem. I think that's really all in that. I thought your comments were all really insightful. And this was a fun format. So thanks so much for having me out here.
Go ahead and dismiss us.
We're headed out, so thanks, everybody.
Thank you.
Bye.
Thank you.
Follow up, Eric.